Good morning, everyone, and welcome back after the summer recess. This is the third meeting of the Health and Sport Committee in the Scottish Parliament's fifth session. Could I ask everyone to switch off their mobile phones as they can interfere with the sound system? The first item on our agenda is a decision on whether to take agenda item 4 in private. This item relates to the implications of the EU referendum and the work of the committee. And the paper is an approach paper for future work, and such items are usually taken in private, so can we agree that, please? Yes. Thank you. The second item on the agenda is subordinate legislation with three negative instruments today. The first instrument is the Foods for Specific Groups Scotland Regulations 2016, SSI 2016-190. There's been no motion to annul, however, the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee did make comment on the regulation. It noted that the regulations are meant to make further consequential amendments to the food intended for use in energy-restricted diets for weight reductions regulations 1997, which are required as a result of the changes to the 1997 regulations introduced by Regulation 6. The Scottish Government accepts the amendment made by Regulation 6 has not led to sufficient clarity in the 1997 regulations and also notes it's undertaken to further amend the 1997 regulations at the earliest available opportunity. Can I now invite any comments from members? Nope. Somehow I didn't think so. Has the committee agreed to make no recommendations? Thank you. The second instrument is the Food Information Scotland Amendment Regulations 2016, SSI 2016-191. There's been no motion to annul, and the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee has not made any comments on the instrument. Again, could I invite any comments from members? Okay. Is the committee agreed to make no recommendations? Thank you. And the third instrument is the National Health Service Free Prescriptions and Charges for Drugs and Appliances Scotland Amendment Regulations 2016, SSI 2016-195. Again, there's no motion to annul, and the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee has not made any comments on the instrument. Again, could I ask any comments from members? Is it agreed that we make no recommendations? Yes. Thank you very much. The second item on the agenda today is two evidence sessions on delayed discharge. Could I welcome to the committee Stephen Fitzpatrick, Head of Older People's Services, Glasgow City Health and Social Care Partnership, Katrina Renfrew, Director of Planning and Policy, NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde, and Councillor Matt Kerr, Executive Member for Social Justice, Glasgow City Council. We're not expecting any opening statements from the witnesses, so could I move first to questions? And you know, we have a large committee, so therefore it would be appreciated if both questions and answers were brief so we get through as much as possible. I'll maybe open up myself. Yesterday we heard from the Cabinet Secretary, who was praising Glasgow City Council and the reductions that they had made in delayed discharge and the progress that had been made. Can you maybe give us a indication of how that progress has been made over what looks like a relatively short period of time?
Yeah, I hadn't appreciated that. That's nice to hear. It has been a short but intense period of change in Glasgow. The story probably goes back about 4 or 5 years when the delays numbers were probably at their worst memory, running probably about 300 over 6 weeks in Glasgow. And we recognised, and I think that was the first stage in the process, it was really important that the Health Board and the Council recognised that this was a strategic priority that together we had to address. So that was a really key point, I think, of making the change. We then spent a couple of years working really closely in partnership between social work, as was pre-health and social care partnerships, the CHP, the community health part of the system, and the acute system, to try to improve the existing system and performance around that. So there was a lot of managerial attention given to trying to improve performance. And what we've seen from the period from around May 2011 to about middle of 2014 was an improvement down from that level of about 300 delays over 6 weeks to probably about 100 to 150 delays at that point. So what we recognised at that point was that we had exhausted the potential for the system to improve performance just through a managerial approach, and we had to reform the system fundamentally. So there was a recognition in 2014 that we had to do that. One of the issues that we had to deal with at that time was what we described as almost a tail of people who had been delayed in hospital for quite a long time, and the only way to deal with that was a kind of one-off investment in care home placement. So the council at that point agreed to find somewhere in the region of £3 million to effectively create a steady state, so that we were only dealing with demand as it came through rather than the residual demand that had built up over time through that historical kind of challenge that we faced. But we also, at that point, as I say, had recognised that there was a need to reform the system, and fundamentally what we decided to do in Glasgow was to introduce intermediate care at scale, so that no one was being assessed for long-term care, wherever possible, from a hospital bed, that if they were fit for discharge, they could move to an appropriate environment for the long-term assessment to take place. And one of the key underpinning principles there was that assessment in hospital, because of all the system pressures, tended to lead to poorer assessments than otherwise would be the case. So intermediate care and the provision of that space at scale across the system was key, and part of, alongside that, the introduction of a target of 72-hour discharge for older people, excluding some categories, AWI, etc., where the needs were more complex, but for your typical older person coming through the acute system, we would apply that 72-hour target and move someone into intermediate care. The numbers bear out, we don't always achieve that, but it certainly made a huge difference in terms of the throughput from acute out to for social care assessment, for long-term assessment. There's a whole lot, and I know you've asked to keep the answers brief, we'll probably come into some of the details as we go through about what underpinned that cultural change, system pathways, processes and so on. But that was the kind of fundamental system change, and principally, again, we needed investment for that to happen. That couldn't be done from within existing resources. So the Integrated Care Fund, before that, the Change Fund that the Scottish Government allocated local partnerships was invested principally. And the priority was around delayed discharges and trying to develop a system that would affect that throughput. And what we've seen in that time is a significant reduction in our older people delays across the city. So when we introduced the 72-hour target in Glasgow on the 1st of December 2014, we had 117 people 65 plus who were delayed more than 72 hours. As of, the numbers fluctuate, but the lowest recently was in March this year. We had reduced that to about 14 or 15, so it was an 80% reduction in that time. So that was, in short, what we've done. It kind of a long way behind that.
Just a brief point on specifics of intermediate care. What does that mean? Where does that take place? What type of settings?
Yes, it's a step-down care for people who are deemed fit for discharge, so they no longer require acute medical care. They go to a number of care homes across Glasgow. We have six, I think, at the moment, across the city. One of the key features of intermediate care is that for people to cooperate, for families and for patients to cooperate with the move, it needs to be somewhere local within their community. So we need a geographical coverage across the city, which is why we have it in different places, different locations. There's also an optimum size for it to work, because by definition, these are the people who are most complex, who can't just go home with home care or lower level packages of support. They tend to be the people most likely to be assessed for long-term care home care. So there is an optimum number beyond which the care homes themselves struggle to cope, but it's all independent sector, privately provided care homes that we use in Glasgow.
Alison.
Thank you, Convener. I'd just like to ask a question about the submission from the Integrated Joint Board. I thought it was quite an interesting response to question 8. And it is, what do you identify as the main... Sorry, I'll let you find that.
Yep, got it. Thank you.
Yeah. The question is, what do you identify as the main barriers to tackling delayed discharges in your area? Now, from my experience in Lothian, it's often lack of a care package, or frequently home adaptations haven't taken place. But I was quite interested in the response, which is continuing professional and community culture of risk aversion rather than risk management in relation to the care of older people. Just wondered if you could, anyone on the panel could flesh that out a little. Perhaps.
Who's first?
Do you want me to give Stephen a break, maybe, if that's helpful? Essentially, I think that there's a series of cultural issues about whether people can go home or not, and a series of expectations that families have that once somebody who has had a pretty significant hospital admission is then, in our view, ready for discharge, a family's expectation is often they're not going to go home or they're going to go straight to a long-term care placement. I think what intermediate care has done for the city is created a space between an acute hospital episode and a final discharge decision from inpatient care. So a patient can move into a care home environment, but without an expectation that they'll be there for the rest of their lives. So the risk issue, I think, is I think often a difference between different kinds of professionals about what is suitable to send people home with a package. And if people have come from difficult home circumstances or have issues about their physical health, often the social care view is that they should be able to make a decision to go home, and we try and put a package around them and minimise risk. The family expectation may be quite different, and sometimes hospital staff expectation is quite different. So what intermediate care has delivered for us is a bridge between the two, because somebody is going into a care home, but they're not going in with a lifelong expectation. There's further intensive rehabilitation, further assessment to see if they can then be got home. I mean, if I can just emphasise kind of the numbers, if that's okay, convener, just very briefly, that if I went back to our peak of delayed discharges, and we count them in lost bed days, because that's what's significant to the hospital sector, is how many beds are consumed every day by delayed discharge. In 11-12, we had 109,000 bed days in Greater Glasgow and Clyde that were taken up by patients waiting for social care outside hospital, not just the city, because we deal with eight or nine different local authorities. By the time we get to April 2016, we're down to 31,000 bed days. So the change is dramatic. From my point of view, and I think from an acute NHS point of view, there is still a long way to go, because those 31,000 bed days are still a big issue for us in terms of how we're trying to run the throughput for acute. But that is a transformational change in 4 or 5 years, both for patients, for acute services, and for what the social care teams have been able to do.
Thank you, convener. Can I just ask a follow-up question? Are you optimistic, the 31,000, the remaining discharge, will you be able to tackle that through education, stakeholder engagement? You speak about that in response to the next question. Or is that a resource issue? I mean, I think, Mr. Fitzpatrick, you were pointing out that sometimes the private care homes are full. What happens then?
The 31,000, if you like, is going to be a mixture of a whole series of different things. Resources are really important, and I think when we talk about the funding for the health service, if social care services are not funded at the level they need to be, then the health service can't function. So the balance across the whole system of care in terms of investment and resources is absolutely fundamental. Hospitals cannot work without social care, community services, not just social care, but community services and indeed GP services more generally being funded and integrated with them. So I think resources are an issue. I think there are still issues about some of the more complex patients and finding non-hospital solutions for people with acquired brain injury, for example, with some of the more complex physical disabilities, and they make up a chunk of that 31,000 bed days. There's still challenges around patients who don't have capacity and getting them out of hospital. But if you ask me whether I'm optimistic, we are working with our partners in the HSCPs on all of those areas. And one thing I think that has changed, and I think Stephen highlighted it in his introductory comments, is we are all on the same ship trying to actually address that problem. So in the 5-10 years that we've improved things, I think people have come together much more to see this as a shared, genuinely shared problem. But resources are a huge worry, because if there isn't money in community services, then hospitals can't function. And I think the other caveat to add to that is we actually need to reduce the acute sector. If we shift these patients, then the money that's in acute beds needs to shift into supporting patients better in the community. And that's a major issue for us. We're trying to reshape our acute hospitals to reflect that change in delayed discharges. And that's very politically challenging for us and very publicly challenging, because the public still see hospital beds as the kind of denominator of a good health service, not necessarily some of the services that Stephen's talked about that are being provided in the community are much less visible. Is that fair?
I think so. Yeah, absolutely. If I could come in on that, I think it seems because we're straying a little bit into the political, I guess. I mean, it's been a bugbear of mine over my. This is my second stint doing the social work job in Glasgow, and I left the post in the end of 2013, just as integration was getting itself moving, if you like, in terms of the new act. So I've come back to it 6 months ago, and a lot has changed. But some aspects in terms of the resource issues and things like that have stayed the same. But the cultural change has been fantastic in that period. But certainly when I came into post in 2010. In the social work post, the CHCPs in Glasgow had just broken up. It just failed. And that was a very, very difficult moment for us, for all of us. You know, these two guys were very involved in things at that time, and you know, they'll know far more about than I will. So I walked into a situation that was very difficult indeed. And really what happened then, slowly but surely, we had to rebuild said relationships at the kind of higher level. Because a lot of the working relationships were okay anyway. It was really the problem was if we're honest with ourselves at a political level too. It was difficult to patch those things up. Getting that kind of side of the culture thing helped us going into the new act. But the other cultural challenge that's alluded to there, in terms of the professionals, but also the public as well. That also feeds into Katrina's final point there about how we look. And this is a collective problem, actually, for the political classes, if we're honest with ourselves, in that politicians of all parties and the media as a result of that, or maybe these things feed back on themselves a little bit, we have a tendency of looking at NHS and looking at care as being hospitals, as measuring success and how many beds we have, how many nurses we employ or how many doctors we employ, rather than measuring success and how healthy our population is. That is a really challenging thing to say out loud for a politician. And I understand all the difficulties of that better than many, I'm sure. But I'm sure many of you have come across these sorts of difficulties in your own constituencies. It's not an easy discussion to have with the public, but it's actually an honest discussion that needs to take place. We need a genuine transfer of resources into not just social care, but community care in the round, because we want to break down the barrier between health and social care itself properly. We need to talk about actually building this integrated service from the ground up. And I have to say, in terms of the consultation response, I'll be back in the day to the Integration Act, to the Public Bodies Act, sorry. That was one of the concerns that we raised in Glasgow, was that we get the principle, we support the principle of this, of the move to integration, but we just felt that a better approach would be to start at the very beginning in the communities. Where are our GPs? Where are our community nurses based? Could our social workers be based, and our other care professionals be based, and building it up that way? That's not to say that's impossible now, but it's very, very possible, but we need a clear... we need to build a political consensus around that, quite frankly, and we need to think very carefully about how that's funded in the future, because it's tricky.
Thanks very much for coming along.
Sure.
And I'll focus a bit down on
some of the numbers, and thanks for Katrina for clarifying, because some questions on that, and I think you've answered them. I think your 31,000 number you're talking about is your annualised number.
15-16, so the financial year just ended.
That was the total for that year. Yeah. Great. Okay. Going on from that, I want to talk about the financial implications of that. If you look at the integration agenda, a big part of the justification was 150 million or whatever it was, savings across a number of areas, one of which delayed discharge. If you look through the data we've got from the NHS Information Service Division, they're coming out with a number of £214 per day for average cost for per bed in acute. I don't know if that number reflects kind of what you're seeing. So I suppose the question is, how much is the cost if you move somebody into intermediate care in comparison with that? And given the substantial reduction you've had, have you seen those numbers flowing through? And if not, why not?
If I can start just with hospital bed numbers, we have less acute beds now in Glasgow than we had in the early 2000s, mid-2000s, and part of the part of the financing of opening the new Queen Elizabeth Hospital was to increase efficiency and therefore to have somewhat less acute beds. I think I haven't got that figure to hand, but I think it's about 150 less acute beds. So there is a flow through of having less delayed discharges, so having less acute care. I think where the challenge is now coming for us is we need to look at sites, because actually reducing beds in hospitals, in big acute hospitals, is not a particularly economic way to deliver care. So we want to achieve maximum transfer into community services, and Matt's right to say it's not just social care services, it's GP services, it's community health services and social care services, by looking at the costs and the whole of our estate right across NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde. And we still have acute older people services on 7 or 8 sites, and we don't see that as a viable model going forward as we start to further develop the kinds of services that we're talking about. And that, I'm not making a political point with a capital P, but a public political point, that's a very challenging discussion. I have to say the counter side as well, though, to the reduction in delayed discharges is there are pressures in a number of our hospitals on admissions. So unfortunately, as is often the case with the health service, nature abhors a vacuum. And as quickly, to some extent, you feel as we've cleared delayed discharges, more patients have presented themselves for emergency care. Not true across the piece, but true in parts of our patch, and you can probably see that from the ISD data.
So just on the number, do you have the comparable number? Does the 214 sound right, and do you have a comparable number for care homes?
Yeah, the general rule of thumb is a hospital bed costs twice as much as a social care bed, is the general rule of thumb.
Right, okay, and you reckon you've seen those savings coming through then, because it comes to whatever, 8 million or 10 million or something?
Yeah, just in terms of the intermediate care places, we roughly pay about £740 a week care bed. There are obviously, we haven't done the exact comparison in terms of ancillary costs and so on. I think it's also important to say, in terms of the overall efficiency idea around this, is this hasn't just been motivated by more efficient discharge from hospital, but also trying to shift the balance of care in terms of the number of people going home. And as I say, by definition, those that were entering intermediate care were most likely to almost 100% when we started. I think 99% of the first cohort that went through intermediate care went into long-term care. The most recent 2 periods we've had, 4-week periods, have been 38 and 42% of people going home. And that's been a big shift for us. So we would expect to see the economic benefit of that further down the care pathways for those individuals too. So it's quite a complex picture, but we think we're moving the right way on it.
Okay.
Our model is moving towards trying to get out of acute hospitals anyone who doesn't require acute care, and that would require a smaller hospital base. And again, just to put it in context, it's not just about delayed discharges for HSCPs. There's all sorts of other delays in systems in acute hospitals that we're trying to address as well. So people waiting for imaging, for example, or waiting for results, or waiting for the ambulance service. We are working really hard across acute to try and get people out quickly, and also to try and shift unplanned care to planned care. So if people can have an urgent outpatient assessment, for example, they don't get admitted, they come back the next day. So trying to change the system of care, and delayed discharge for community service is just one component of that.
Thank you, Convener. At our residential away weekend this weekend, we had a presentation from the National Clinical Director who walked newbies like me through the idea of what causes delayed discharge. It was very useful. He gave an example of an elderly woman who'd taken a fall spent 10 days in hospital, but only required 10 days of care. However, because her normal social care package at home had been stopped for the duration of her hospital stay, she had to stay in hospital for a further 9 days while that was reinstituted. And that, you know, in a nutshell, is the cause of delayed discharge. He then went on to explain that the way that they'd dealt with that for this patient was, in fact, the introduction of hospital at home, so that when she had similar circumstances further down the line, that she didn't actually have to leave her house. She had the same standard of care, but none of the problems associated with delayed discharge. I wonder if the panel can give us your reflections on innovative practices like hospital at home and where they fit in to the mix. Obviously not for everybody, particularly in very acute cases, but where they fit in.
I think they're part of that, creating a much broader spectrum of care. I've worked for the NHS for over 30 years, and when I first started, you were either in hospital or not in hospital or in a care home. There were only kind of 3. It was a pretty short algorithm. And now the algorithm across Scotland and indeed across the UK will have a whole number of nodes of delivering service. And I think that, we can continue to develop new models of care. I think one of the critical pivots of all of that is the role of GPs. And I think that's a real pressure point for us at the moment, that GPs, the demands that GPs have in their own practices, just keeping on top of the daily work, is huge. And GPs' willingness now to be part of some of these more innovative models of care, because most of these patients still do need some kind of medical oversight. And if it's not being done in the hospital, you need GPs to be a core component of those sorts of services. So going forward for us, one of the worries is GPs' time, capacity, interest in being part of those kind of teams and those kind of models. And I think that's essential to make them work. I don't know if you agree, Stephen.
Absolutely agree with that. I think that's, as you shift the balance of care, people still have needs. And if it's met in a more efficient way, that's what, but your whole system needs to change around that. And that isn't always straightforward, and it takes time. And there is risk through that. And I think that comes back to the point about we need as a system to be willing to embrace that change and the risks that come with it, and to manage those.
If I can just say on that, I mean, it comes back a little bit to the point I made earlier on about how GPs fit into the system more widely, you know. And I think there's they're overworked. I don't really necessarily say overpaid, but certainly overworked. And they're not rationally distributed either. If we're talking about tackling health inequalities, there's an issue about how our GPs are distributed around, and there's issues there about what the NHS can do to influence that, and it's not always a straightforward exercise at all. And I think there's something there about how, you know, if we are trying to rebuild this thing as a truly integrated service, we need to think a little bit about where GPs and how we integrate services around them. Ideally, in a kind of one stop, the ideal is this one stop shop kind of place you visit. But it was interesting the example you gave about somebody being in that situation, being in hospital, coming back out, and then the delay because the service had gone. I mean, I would hope. I mean, I'm always hesitant to say that this would never happen in Glasgow, but I would say something like that would be less likely. Yeah. We have partly, I would say, I'm quite proud to say this. The council's company Cordia, that provides the care service, has, I think I'm right in saying, around about 90%, 96% of the work. Its scale gives us a huge advantage in being able to deal with, first of all, new cases come into the system, because just the size of the organisation means it can actually, sometimes you hear stories that if a large organisation can't react like that. In this case, it works, because we've got the staff, we've got well trained staff, well paid staff, properly resourced, and they can then take on that extra case when required. But it also means in a situation like you've described there, we could also get the service back in place relatively quickly. So I would hope that kind of scenario would be less likely in our area.
I think that's fair. I think that we were talking outside about some of the problems in providing home care services that local authorities or HSCPs outside the urban areas have, and that is a real issue for us, because we're distributing patients back from acute care all over the kind of west of Scotland, and we notice that contrast between the reliability and the durability of home care in the city and the more urban authorities, and much more challenge for rural authorities. But I think Matt's right. I wouldn't, if I went through today's list of delayed discharges, I would not expect to find patients, certainly from the city, from our more urban areas, that are delayed for that reason, waiting for home care. There are some from other authorities outside Glasgow. But that's not necessarily an unwillingness to provide home care. It's a recruitment problem. It's a scale problem.
Thanks very much. I'm interested when you talk about the issue of delayed discharge. I'm very interested in the idea of preventing admission in the first place. And I think that's probably where I imagine that's where you're focusing to try and reduce the last 30-odd thousand lost days. Do you want to tell me a little bit about what you're doing to avoid admission? I wonder if you're using your interim beds as step-up beds, or if there are, you know, more flexible palliative care packages and things that are being delivered at home, or what sort of things are you doing to avoid admission in the first place?
There's no care being delivered at home, so if you look back over 3 or 4 years, the investment in rehabilitation at home is significantly greater than it was. Our geriatricians are doing more outreach, so rather than being solely focused on acute care, they're now working with Stephen and his team looking at intermediate care models and being part of the team in the way that old age psychiatrists have traditionally done for a longer time. So a lot of patients in nursing homes would still have some oversight from an old age psychiatrist. So our acute geriatricians are beginning to develop that model. At the front door, we're looking at things like assessment and discharge, urgent outpatients, ambulances doing triage. There's a whole range of different things that we're doing. I think one of the anxieties that always needs to be kind of on the table is we need to make sure that older people are not deprived of acute hospital care that they actually do need. So we're always very careful of saying unnecessary admissions. It's different ways of managing that particular kind of need at the time, rather than saying, let's try and stop older people getting acute assessment and top quality acute care, because we need to deliver that. But when they are admitted, we need to get them back out quickly. And that's where Stephen and I probably part company a bit, and I probably part company with the government, which is unwise. The idea that 72 hours is a success, for me a success, is when somebody leaves hospital when they're ready to go. So if you're ready to go on Tuesday, going on Tuesday is what we should deliver for you, not going on Friday. And I think, to be fair, although you do talk about the 72 target, when we're in our kind of detailed discussions, we are looking to get people out on the day that they're ready to leave medically, not on that day plus three. So if I was setting targets, I would be much more focused. That's why we use bed days, because that's a real measure of the resource lost. That we need to get people out on the same day that they're ready and change that culture a bit.
No, I don't think we disagreed too much on the 72 hours is a notional target, Alan. The aspiration, I think, is to get people out. We recognise that hospitals, once people have had their medical needs attended to, it's not a healthy place for older people to be, and that's really driven a lot of our change in practice and system. I think on your particular point, we do have step-up beds in the city. As we move, we're actually progressing with a tender now. We developed as a proof of concept in procurement terms, but we're now moving to implement a tender in the city for our intermediate care, and those beds will be used flexibly for step up and step down, and we have systems and processes to try to ensure that the right people are going in, because someone stepping up tends to have different medical needs. It's much more kind of acute medical intervention, if you like, for those people. We have that developed over the last couple of years in the city, and that will be across the city. I think in strategic terms, the big focus is we've talked about over the last number of years has been around reducing delays and delayed discharges, and notwithstanding the 31,000 bed days across the board data, then which will continue to be a priority. Increasingly, our attention now strategically is on unscheduled care and preventing admission in the first place and diversion. A whole load of different initiatives around that, and trying to build on the momentum that we've built up around delays and an appetite for change and doing things differently, which we hope to apply in relation to our unscheduled care strategy. We've got some new statutory duties around strategic planning for that, which we're working through with our partners in the acute system and other HSCPs in the board area. But Step Up will be part of that, as will anticipatory care planning, as will be how we configure our multidisciplinary teams in and around the hospital, and trying to divert people who might turn up at A&E, how we're working with care homes who are big referrers to acute hospital. So it's multifaceted, and we've got a whole detailed plan, and I'm happy to share, but we're working through that, and it will take time for that to bear fruit too.
It's maybe worth referencing your point on palliative care. One of the things we're trying to do as we move away from NHS continuing care, which we're working our way out of, is to transform those beds into community-based palliative care, but for people who can't die at home, so that we can offer something other than the hospice movement, which is a tiny number of beds, for people who are in end-of-life care and who previously would have had to die in hospital because they couldn't necessarily be looked after at home. So the move away from continuing care, I think we're already seeing kind of benefits of being able to offer in care homes more extended packages of support for patients, again with the geriatricians providing input to that that they wouldn't have done in previous kind of care home models.
One of the things that would be, it's key to kind of delivering a change like that, I would say, is back to a recurring point, and that's having that kind of honest discussion with the public whose services it is, and that's that, you know, there's a lot of people when their granny's no well, they expect her to go into a residential care home, and it's not necessarily the right thing to do, but it's maybe what we've all grown to expect over the years. It's not to say that it isn't right for some folk, of course it is, but we have to change that kind of mindset amongst a lot of people, and that's not an easy thing to do, because you're dealing with people's loved ones, you're dealing with people's lives, and it's a difficult conversation to have politically. I'm sure all of you have had casework on things like this. I certainly have, And it's a really difficult conversation to have with some folk, and try and reassure them that you can genuinely give them a life and a kind of support that they need and they deserve in a setting that's hopefully more comfortable and safe than the Cecilia Hospital might be. Not that I'm saying hospitals are unsafe. You get my point. That's a wee challenge to us as politicians, I would say.
Picking up on those points, is it ever a problem in terms of beds that the care homes that people might be getting into, either in the interim system you've described or the more longer term sort of residency, is the number of beds available ever an issue, or are you able to place people?
In Glasgow, it's not an issue. I know it is in other parts of Scotland.
And I say that.
In Edinburgh, for example, yeah. I mean, it's partly a symptom about land values and speculative building and so on. So in the east end of Glasgow, we have a very high concentration of care homes and care home places because it was relatively cheap at one time to build and develop. And we don't commission that as an authority. It's a marketplace. So we have never had an issue in terms of capacity. I think in Glasgow, current capacity is running around 88-90% across the system, which always gives us that room for manoeuvre, if you like.
I've got to say this, and I am duty bound, that the City Council itself, over the last few years, we've invested £100 million in new council owned and run residential care homes for the elderly. So it's not that we believe that there isn't a need for that kind of support in the future. But what that does actually in having our own in-house service, it gives us a good position in that kind of, we're not in a position that some authorities have found themselves in, so to no fault of their own, but they're kind of at the mercy of I guess, you know, what the market might provide. And as Stephen has said, the market, so to speak, doesn't always provide here because of the land prices and what have you. So there is a strategic case actually for local authority investment in this. At the very least, to have a foothold in that, to keep things honest.
I think one of the problems around care homes is the public perception. There's still a sense that's privatising the healthcare. So when I still engage with people, and indeed when we engaged in changes years ago around some of our sites, people remember maybe Cow Glen and places, there was a real sense that healthcare was being privatised because the contracting would be done out into care homes that were, quite a lot of them run by charities, to be fair, but were not run by the public sector. And I think that's still a real issue when you engage with the public. We're in a debate at the moment about the future of acute beds we've got at Lightburn Hospital, and part of the reprovision, if we proceed with that, would be local care homes. Now, they're good because they give you a very local service, much more than we could do off acute sites. They've got very good facilities, you know, they're good providers who've invested in their facilities, but the public perception will still be that should be in the public sector, it shouldn't be in the private or charitable sector, and that's a challenging debate sometimes with patients or patients' relatives.
In the response to the questions, you say you don't record expenditure solely for the purpose of reducing delayed discharge. How do you know how much you need?
Have we got? Well, this is not a straightforward thing. I'll leave the science bit to these guys in a moment here. But look, there's an issue here. But there's been two different cultures actually. I'm sitting between them, I don't get a hard time off of both of them now. But there's been a difference in cultures and how councils run their budgets to how the NHS runs its budgets. Right, it's a different, and there are long term reasons for that. About how, you know, it's just not been possible for councils to run overspends in certain ways, in the way that parts of the NHS have been able to do. And I can feel Katrina looking at me now. You know, over the years, there's been an expectation, frankly, that successive governments, have been able to then stand behind the relevant authority and bail them out. And I don't mean that in too negative a sense. It's what needs to happen, but that's not necessarily happened in local authorities. The mechanisms that we work under are quite different. To give you a wee example, my last stint in social work, a third of Glasgow's council spend went on social work. So that's an awful lot of money. Not enough, but it's it's an awful lot of money, right? And it gives you some sense of the scale of need, certainly in the city. But I could tell you that now we could spend it twice over. Now, we got to the point that I remember, I think it was the January, and I was reporting to the executive committee, or at least the city treasurer was reporting to the executive committee, and there was the probable outturns for the various departments come forward. Our probable outturn at that time for social work was to be £18 million overspent. And that was there at the same time as he was reporting that the council's reserves were sitting at £18 million. So to say that was a scary thing, we put it mildly, and to say there weren't difficult discussions that took place after that, you know, is also put it mildly. But that overspend can happen really, really rapidly in something like social care, as it can in NHS. You know, you can have one secure placement for a child, and that's £200,000 like that gone. And you know, in a authority with our kind of scale, these sorts of placements, these sort of costs are not at all unusual. And so things can rapidly get a hand. I would say that we've got some, given the difficult experience I've had in hanging on to social work budgets and what have you, you know, we've got some really good officers working for us who managed to watch that spend all the time. But I think the point that was trying to be made, if I'm honest with you, in that answer was that actually we're approaching this not as a cost-saving exercise. Because that can't be what I've been. It was actually one of my wee. I know it wasn't the focus of the Act, in fairness, but it was one of the things mentioned, was that there would be £750 million potential savings in this. I think we are kidding ourselves on if we think that there will be genuine savings for the public sector doing this. What will happen is that, yes, acute we might get to a point where acute spends less money, but the money will be spent in other ways because demand is not about to fall anytime soon. We have an ageing population, and as our population gets older and they get to the point where they do need help, those needs are ever more complex and those treatments are ever more expensive. And so there are a number of complex challenges I'm sure you're all as a committee very well aware of, but I do think they're for successive years they're not really getting to the bottom of this. They're not going to realise savings through this.
Could you see the if you're freeing up bed space because people are moving elsewhere, is that just being filled up by others?
I think the core issue for the NHS is the NHS inflation runs at a very high rate. You'll see every week in the paper new drugs that costs potentially hundreds of thousands per patient. You'll see new treatments being announced. So the complexity of the NHS is the rate at which we can do more for patients if somebody gives us the money. And if there is never a stop that says, actually, that's not a priority for the NHS or the opportunity cost of that is too high, then the acute sector of the NHS will spend more and more money. So what has happened is where we have saved money in some areas, they will have been reinvested in other areas. I think just a headline, we're probably spending £30 or £40 million more on drugs, on prescribing, both in the acute sector and primary care in this financial year than last. That is not covered by the inflation uplift that we've had. So it comes back to this issue about choices. Do we want to have really, really good community services where people are looked after at home or in more community settings? Or do you want to spend more money on the acute sector? And that choice with the HSCPs now being in place becomes much more explicit. But the more money you spend on acute, the less you spend on other things. And the risk has always been for the NHS services like drug and alcohol services, services for mental health, services for child and adolescent mental health, are Cinderellas because they don't have a public profile. Services about new drugs, new cancer treatments, new pieces of equipment create a public mood that wants to see those provided by the NHS. And that's an intensely difficult debate because there is not enough money for everything.
So just picking up on that, recently the drug and alcohol budget was cut quite significantly and you guys were told to replace that money. Where do you magic that money from?
I think on that specific, we didn't reduce the drug and alcohol budgets that we allocated to the HSCPs by the same amount that had been reduced nationally. and that amount of difference between that national allocation and what we passed on, the gap between that's become part of our financial problem. Our board doesn't at this time have a balanced budget. We're still looking for savings for 16-17, and our acute sector is overspending. So we are, as I think a number of health boards around Scotland are, in a position where the books at the moment don't balance and difficult choices need to be made. Now, if you get those choices wrong, then you undermine the kind of delivery of care that we're talking about here. And if you take money out of community services or mental health services, then you end up with more people in hospital. It's only, despite the fact there are a number of statutory bodies involved in the provision of these services, they're one system for patients. And if we don't have that balance right and we change services in an unplanned way, then you will go back to the 109,000 delayed discharges. You will go back to a system that is completely out of balance. And that's why there's some hard choices to make about how the NHS spends money and what the priorities are.
Clear.
Thank you, Convener. One of the issues repeatedly raised during our inquiry by other health and social care partnerships, and including Glasgow, was the length of the process associated with Adults with Incapacity Act. And I think you've identified that it's cost Glasgow City £1 million in delayed discharges. Can you explain to the committee why the process takes so long, and also what Glasgow City are doing to mitigate that length of time, or how you're trying to remedy that?
I'm happy to have a go, and then Councillor Kerr can come in. It's complex because each individual case is different. I mean, one of the things we have tried to do in Glasgow is apply 13ZA for individuals that are lacking capacity, where it's in their best interest to move without the seeking.
What 13ZA is?
It
lets you move a patient from an acute hospital to a care home in their best interest, basically, which I have to say is objectively the case. Our consultants will always say if somebody's ready to leave hospital, it's in their best interest to be in a more homely environment.
Sometimes that's not possible because someone already has powers, so they have a power of attorney or a guardian, or someone is seeking powers and so on. So every individual case is different. I think that's part of the complexity. There are issues, I think, for the health and care system is that we are not in complete then control of what happens because it's a legal process. And court time has come under pressure, for example, in Glasgow around this, and we've seen increasing court time set aside for consideration of guardianship applications, and then there was a change to that and a reduction in court time because courts are under pressure too, and that then just leads to a delay in powers being in place, and unless powers are in place, you can't move someone from the care of a consultant into a social care environment, for example, which would be the normal route for people. So the court process is certainly part of it. There are issues sometimes around how assiduous a solicitor might be. Very often it's a private solicitor that's acting on behalf of a family member or relative that's seeking guardianship powers, and we have heard of cases of people going off long-term sick or going on holiday and so on, and that just prolongs the time before guardianship is in place. What we are trying to do, apart from the application 13ZA, is performance manage the process, and we have a policy position now where the partnership will seek to intervene through the courts if we think the process isn't, a private application isn't being pursued as assiduously as it should be, and we can seek power to intervene in that case. That's a complex managerial process because these cases are held by countless care managers, social workers across our system, so trying to manage all of that is an undertaking, but it's certainly a priority for us to do that. The other thing that we have done, initiated in Glasgow at a more kind of strategic level, was the Power of Attorney campaign. To try to I suppose educate the public about this issue and the risk that a loved one or you yourself would end up in a situation where you're in limbo effectively because of the guardianship process and so on, and about being in your best interest that someone can move you, someone you trust could hold powers of attorney and make decisions on your behalf if those circumstances arose. So that was an investment that started in Glasgow a couple of years ago and has certainly developed. And we've now got a number of health boards and HSCPs that have been investing in that campaign, and it's been very successful in generating applications to the extent that the Office for Public Guardian sometimes struggles with the demand that comes through. It's always unintended consequences. But that will be a long-term benefit, I think. We would expect to see this have the benefit not right away, because it, you know, many people taking the powers of attorney may not have to use them for many years and you get the benefit further down the line. So we're coming at it from a number of different ways, but it's always been a major issue and a major stress to the acute system. The other thing that we have done strategically in the last couple of years is to commission beds in care homes in the city. A couple of care homes in particular, these people remain NHS patients under the care of a consultant, but they aren't in an acute bed, they're in a place off-site, which has relieved some of the pressure on the acute system in the city. So that we're trying to come at this from a number of different ways to manage it.
I could just add one other thing, and apart from the power of attorney campaign, is another part of the front end of that system, if you like, is when we're, you know, we have a very, very successful kind of support a kind of network in place for carers in the city, and got a great team working on that. And one of the things they do is we identify carers and we get carers' assessments done. This idea of the power attorney, or the possibility of it, is one of the discussions that can be thrown into that mix, as appropriate, obviously. So that's another. We try not to miss an opportunity to have that discussion with somebody as early as possible in the process, you know. But yeah, the big snag seems to be, as we've had that kind of lump, if you like, going through the system, the system's kind of ground to a halt a little bit in some places. So.
But that, the short term thing is key, that we've got these interim beds, which are not the same as intermediate, just to confuse everybody, where our consultants are still clinically responsible for the patients, but they're not on acute sites. So we're doing what's in the best interest of the patients, but we're not falling foul of the law, because we keep NHS responsibility for those patients. But they're not sitting in an acute hospital taking up beds or being in the wrong environment for them.
Richard.
I've sat and listened to you intently, and I compliment you what you've done, but can I get a handle on this? You say it was reduced, delayed discharge in the city by 70%. So that's money saved. The government, when they brought out the public bodies bill, said that we'd save between £100 and £150 million over Scotland. So the money you save because people are not in those beds, are you now spending that in acute services? Are you now, and you moved into, you said a minute ago, you were about drugs and things. So basically, can I ask, the money we're saving because people now no longer are sitting in the hospital at the cost per bed, now is getting spent in other places, and really, we're not going to save any money. You might be overspent. Is that what we're saying?
I think you have and you will save money around the costs of delayed discharge in acute services. But every year when we reset our budget, there will be another series of funding demands that will then... So there'll be a saving comes in, if you like, as a source of funding in terms of the pressures around delays, but then there'll be 30 or 40 other... applications of funding that come in every year, which we're expected to fund. And if you looked at the budget for 16-17, there was the NHS uplift included, I think, £500 million that was taken out the NHS uplift and given immediately to local authorities. So although in our board's headline figure there was, I think, £150 million, I'm probably exaggerating, I haven't got the numbers in front of me, but there was a multi-million amount of money that we pass straight to the health and social care partnerships. So when health service uplifts are shown at a kind of headline level as very large sums of money, certainly a large chunk of that in 16-17 was given quite rightly to the health and social care partnerships to finance the development of social care. But the concept of a kind of a spare sum of money in the health service that's just waiting for somebody to spend it isn't one that I would ever have recognised.
I've also got is some of the boards now, the joint boards, are saying that they don't have enough money, that they didn't get enough money. Now, I also was a councillor many years ago, and you get your budget, so you have your budget, you have the headline figures. You know, have we ensured that we've put all the money that we should have put in to set up the joint boards? Have we ensured that that's been done, or have, with the greatest respect when I say this, are some of the joint boards been shortchanged?
One of the problems of the construct of the HSCPs is the health board allocates their money. So we're allocating across acute and the HSCPs. So when there is a pressure on the board's overall budgets, we have to distribute that between the acute sector and the HSCPs. So certainly in our case, we started with the ambition to fully fund the HSCPs and try and limit the level of savings that they had to achieve compared to the acute division. But there is a savings target for our HSCPs, and we have not yet identified with across the services how those savings will be delivered. And we are, as I've said, also overspending on our acute care. So there is a financial problem right across the system. But I suppose what I would say in Glasgow, and Matt's obviously a board member of the NHS board as well, which he's concealing from me at the moment, is it was a very difficult budgeting process for us, and we're still not in balance on those very difficult choices about what we can't afford to do, because that's the reality. The opportunity cost of certain things means we can't afford to do them. Is a challenging debate every year, and I think that this has certainly been the most difficult financial year we've had as a health board.
I would say, well, we've got that in common, at least. It's the most difficult financial year I've known as a councillor, anyway. I don't think I'll be alone in that across Scotland. In terms of being shortchanged, I think, as a board member, I've got to be quite careful, I guess, but I think the board has put in what it should. In terms of its input into the, and I think the council has too. As I said earlier on, a third of the council's budget goes into social care in Glasgow, and we took the decision for very, very sound service reasons, apart from anything else, to put just about everything in to this partnership. And so there is no question that in my view, that there's a commitment financially from the council around that. Look, I'm trying not to be too party political here, and I'm not going to do it. But there is a point here about how local authorities have been funded in the long term here. I've been a councillor now for 9 years. My local authority has been cut every year for 9 years. A third of our spending goes in social care. You can't take that amount of money out of local government and not expect it to have an effect on social care. Especially when a third of your spend is on it, it's going to have an effect, right? Now you do your best, and you know, and we work with everyone we can to try and mitigate those effects. But at the end of the day, it will increase the pressure, and it brings situations like delayed discharge to a head. Now, we, through kind of hard work in terms of integration, have managed to get ourselves where we have now, and I'm really, really proud of all the staff that worked so hard to achieve that. But I do think there's a wider issue in terms of the funding of the entire system that needs to get looked at. Not just, I mean, Katrina's mentioned, you're always running to, I mean, this definitely won't be news to you, that the NHS is always running to standstill in terms of funding. It was always thus, going right back to Bevan. But you set a budget, it will be spent, don't worry. But it's the same in social care, especially in a city like Glasgow, where need is huge. And say we're not the only people in that, but I understand that across the country. But you have a situation that's not really been addressed. I think there has to be I think at some point the political class, and I mean this in the widest possible sense across all the parties, we need to level with the public about this. This system right now, I'm proud that I'm here talking about how we've done well in Glasgow in terms of our delayed discharges. But I really worry that kind of progress isn't permanent and isn't sustainable unless we have a genuine discussion with the public about how our care services are funded in the long term.
With the greatest respect, you reduce your delayed discharge by 70%. So where's that 70% of that money went to?
It will have been part of the budget planning process at the end of each year will be, in total, what new pressures have we got and how are we going to finance that. I have to say there is definitely new investment in community-based services in the HSCPs compared to where you were 3 or 4 years ago. So there is a greater range of community services and greater spending on them, but that hasn't closed the whole financial gap. And it is an extremely worrying position to be in, that we still have savings targets to meet in this year, and inevitably when you're making short-term savings, they're not necessarily the most sensible things to do. And the core issue is going to be what size of acute sector is deliverable and affordable, what size of an acute workforce, because there's a series of workforce challenges around acute as well. It's hard, for example, to recruit consultant geriatricians. Some of these difficult issues need to be out in the open for debate. The acute sector will consume as much money as taxpayers want to give it, but you won't then get community services, social care when you want it, home care when you want it, palliative care to die at home. Doing all of that is not possible.
Sorry, just a final very quick word on this. I think the important point to stress here is that this isn't a steady state. We're dealing with new demand and a tidal wave of demand. So every time you take an efficiency, there's a demand coming through to consume it. And that's really, I suppose, what we're experiencing in Glasgow.
Okay, thank you very much for your evidence this morning. And we will be watching the progress that you make with real interest. Can we suspend for a few minutes to change the witnesses, please? Okay, our second panel today is from South Ayrshire. We're not expecting any opening statements, so we'll move to questions. We have with us Tim Eltringham, Director, South Ayrshire Health and Social Care Partnership, Councillor Rita Miller, the Chair of South Ayrshire Integrated Joint Board, and Liz Moore, Director of Acute Services, NHS Ayrshire and Aaron. Again, if I could ask people to be brief with questions and answers, that would be helpful. Alison, do you want to begin?
Thank you, convener. Thank you. I believe you were listening to the previous evidence session, and it seemed that Glasgow weren't focusing so much on a lack of funding or even care home places, but they were speaking about various cultural barriers they had to overcome, as well as those resources. But you've been quite clear in your very detailed response, for which I'm very grateful, that there is insufficient funding to enable the placement of people requiring care home support to leave hospital. So I just wondered, are there actually enough places if there was sufficient funding?
It's interesting. I think if you review the figures that we sent you, I think earlier the last year we were struggling in terms of placement identification, and that was the most significant issue for us. I think as this year, we just in the last few weeks have been able to release some resource to make placements. I think we have found a number of people for whom it's been difficult to make those placements in care homes. The evidence that we submitted, I think, demonstrates that around about 14, 15 months ago, we had a very significant rise in terms of the numbers of people requiring care home places, and that does put pressure on the overall numbers. Clearly, some care homes are more popular than others, and while there may be vacancies in some, obviously family and older people themselves quite often express preferences for those that are the most popular, and that can therefore at sometimes make it appear that there aren't sufficient places altogether.
What sort of unmet demand do you have?
I think we haven't tested that to destruction yet. We are, I think, at this stage confident that the numbers of people that we're looking at who are delays, which are still something between, I think, 20 and 30 altogether, we've placed or arranged funding for around about 30 over the past 4 or 5 weeks. Whether at the end of the day we'll be able to accommodate all of those in the homes of their choice remains to be seen. Clearly, placement in care home and the arrangements and funding and so on are a balance between new people turning up and, in fact, attrition, obviously people dying and places becoming available. I think for us, what we've felt over recent years and probably over the last 2 or 3 years is that there's something in our local system that is perhaps propelling people into care homes a little earlier than we would hope. And so the length of stay is a little longer than we would hope, and that therefore is if you like using up that capacity more than we think would be sensible. And later on, if committee feels it helpful, we could talk a little bit about how we're trying to reduce the numbers of people overall for whom the assessment is the requirement to go to care home.
Yours was one of the few responses that we had that had isolated the expenditure specifically relating to delayed discharges, which is obviously helpful when it comes to measuring progress. But another, you know, way of progressing this issue seems to be around culture, and you speak in your response of hospital staff perhaps having a lack of confidence in the ability of community services to support someone. Is this an issue? You know, obviously it's about education, raising awareness amongst acute staff and others of what is available. Is that happening?
I think our response will be very similar to the one from colleagues from Glasgow. It very often, I think, is very much on a sort of knife edge. People will, you know, within a multidisciplinary team, some will be more risk averse and some will be more risk enabling, if you like. There needs to be a confidence once somebody's in hospital amongst the team who are responsible for the discharge that will be a safe and appropriate discharge. I think I absolutely understand that as one who's worked wholly in my career in the community. Your point is that we need to do everything that we can, I think, reasonably to support that decision-making amongst our acute colleagues. Maybe, Liz, I don't know whether you wish to respond to that?
No, I can corroborate what Tim's saying. I think that in terms of acute services, our acute teams require great confidence in terms of the services that they're discharging their patients home to. And we're doing a range of work just now to build that confidence with community teams, in that we bring community teams into our acute hospitals now to work with our consultants and our ward staff, just to demonstrate the types of services and the range of services that are available for older people. But there is a general risk aversion in terms of older people going home where they maybe don't have full family supports, etc. But that's work that will continue to be ongoing in terms of building the confidence around services as services change. Because we heard from Katrina, there's a whole range of services now available in the community for families, communities and older people. And often acute services don't know that range of services. They're not familiar with everything that can happen in communities. And unless someone can explain to them in great detail that a patient will be safe and someone will be there to visit them at a certain time, they worry about sending patients home. So they look for that. They look for that information. They look for that piece of information. So it's again around education within acute services to advise them of those services and build that confidence through those services integrating with acute hospitals. And that's what we're doing now.
Yeah, thank you.
And can I say there's also the family influence in it, because we have already developed our model, as it were, and we're trying to change it. So it's about families understanding that the community is actually better in most cases for people to be discharged, but they have to feel that their relative is not at you know, any real risk, and the risks have been taken into account. So it is about describing, you know, what this different world is for to families as well, so that they'll be confident and not be, you know, sort of contacting MSPs and contacting other politicians to say, oh, wait a minute, there's a wrong assessment here, I think it should be that. You know, there's this lack of confidence there in some families. I would say others will say, best thing that's ever happened, we didn't want that to happen anyway. So it is about getting the local confidence, if you like, built up. You know, the not just the professional, but the sort of the community confidence built up.
Maybe at the risk of prolonging the answer. Just yeah. a further element to this is in circumstances where somebody has cognitive impairment one way or another, either as a consequence of dementia, a long-term limiting condition, or what's quite often described as delirium. I'm not a medical person, but essentially as a consequence perhaps of a urinary tract infection and so on that might be short-lived. I think in those circumstances where there is that cognitive impairment, colleagues, I think collectively across the health and social care system, are obviously more anxious because people's ability to look after themselves is less robust. I think we recognise locally, and one of the developments that we're keen to progress is a much closer relationship between our colleagues within at the front end of the hospital or at the medical receiving wards and older adult psychiatric services. We're looking to strengthen those arrangements to give clinicians for whom the cognitive impairment is not their area of expertise a degree of confidence that a discharge can be made safely.
Thank you.
Richard.
Thank you, Convener. You would hear my question earlier about the concern I have is that a lot of the joint boards are now suggesting that they don't have enough money. Can I say your submission is excellent? Can I double check your total budget for HSCP 2015-16? Health Board put in 94.6 million, local authority 66.6 million. What is set aside budget? 21.6 million.
The set aside budget, the Integration Joint Board, the Public Bodies Act, recognises that without the Integration Joint Board being able to have an influence on the spend in relation to unscheduled care, it's unlikely that we will make progress with many of the issues that you explored with colleagues from Glasgow in terms of trying to manage that shift, trying to look at unscheduled care in the round. It's as important what happens in somebody's own home, in the GP practice, in accident emergency, in the receiving ward, downstream wards and so on. So we need to kind of look at all of that resource in the round. And what the set-aside budget is an attempt at this stage, probably a little crude if I'm honest, for the Integration Joint Board to understand how much resource in Liz's facilities, in the acute hospital at Ayr in particular, is consumed by the people of South Ayrshire. The Integration Joint Board is charged with overseeing how that resource will be managed in due course. So the Integration Joint Board is responsible for a number of delegated services and the provision of those services through me. The set-aside budget, the unscheduled care, will continue to be managed by the Director of Acute Services and the Health Board directly, but the Integration Joint Board has a say in terms of how that resource should be spent.
Where does that money come from?
That money is essentially Health Board money.
Health Board money, okay. Go back to the question that I asked to Glasgow, you're basically saying, in Code 9 delays, there were 3,196 lost bed days due to Code 9 in 2015. At a cost per night, estimated at £170, the annual cost was £665,000. But now you're saying that the estimated cost 2016-2017-2017-18 will be £489,000 per year, which you'll save about £176,000. Your detail's fantastic, right? I wish we could have got that from the previous. But basically, the nub of my question is, are you going to say you're going to save money? Are you going to say you're going to be overspent? Are you going to say you've been shortchanged?
Okay. My answer perhaps is similar to the colleagues from Glasgow. We can apply a notional cost in relation to Code 9s, and the committee will be aware that we've worked hard on Code 9s, similarly to Glasgow, and are keen to identify people early for whom Adults with Incapacity Act issues emerge. It's a notional cost. The ward that those people are inhabiting, whether there are 2, 3, 4, or 10, is still staffed in terms of the capacity that's required there. Again, Katrina Renfrew from Glasgow and Liz would be able to say broadly the same things, and I'm sure she will in a moment. The demand on the acute service is beyond what anybody, I think, had modelled in terms of the numbers of people emerging at accident and emergency, the numbers of people who require to have treatment in hospital, and therefore the numbers of beds that the system needs at the moment are huge. Trying to identify small pockets of money that are a saving actually is really very difficult. I think you're asking whether we've been shortchanged. I think in terms of the rules of engagement, I think both the NHS and the local authority, I have to be careful what I say in relation to this, but I think they've both played by the rules, and the arrangements, particularly this year, that were more complicated, I think, than in previous years, have been reviewed, I stand up to scrutiny. Have we got enough money? Same answer to our colleagues from Glasgow. I could spend it 2 and 3 times over. I think there are particular pressures this financial year for health and social care partnerships, particularly in relation to the payment of the national living wage, the UK government living wage, the arrangements that we've had to put in place to fund sleepovers, for instance, for people who have 24-hour care, where European legislation is essentially means that we need to pay almost twice as much for a night's care. For South Ayrshire, that's £1.2 million extra that I'm having to pay. No extra care provided. Quite appropriately, people are within the law receiving the payment that's due to them. But in terms of pressure on the service and pressure on the budget, that has been probably the most significant issue. I don't know, Liz, whether you want to say a bit about acute services and demand.
Probably just to put the numbers into context. Over the last 3 years, we've seen an increase in demand in services in terms of patients presenting to our emergency departments. It's been more significant since the winter of this year, and it's continued over the summer, which is quite a different pattern from what we've seen in previous years. And if I look specifically just at the over 65 population, because over 65 population have got a higher tendency to be admitted. So any over 65-year-old person who comes to an ED with an unscheduled care presentation, 60% of those people will be admitted, where the general population is much smaller. It can be in the mid-20s. So in the last 3 years, 3 years ago, we were admitting on average 16 over 65-year-old patients into the Ayr Hospital, and it's the hospital we're talking about today. That's 20 now. So if you take the length of stay on top of every other age group, which is increasing, that's a significant amount of beds. So it appears that could be around 20 beds that we would require now in terms of the increase in the numbers of patients that's come into the system in the last 2 to 3 years. Obviously, you don't want to hear us saying, we need more beds, we're going to build more beds. So that's the sheer demand in the system. And as said, when we were talking to our Glasgow colleagues, we're looking at a number of ways to try and reduce that impact on acute services, because it doesn't help older people to be in acute hospital longer than the time they need to be to receive a very specialist acute period of care. So I'm working particularly with our partnership directors. We've got three partnerships in Ayrshire, and we work together across Ayrshire because patients do move across Ayrshire. South Ayrshire patients don't always remain in Ayr Hospital. They go to other hospitals across Ayrshire. And in terms of our older people services strategy, our aim is to reduce admissions where that's possible. And that's right up to the front door, where we are looking at teams being in ED to try and prevent older people from being admitted where they don't need to be by putting in some care and support. In the acute hospital, we're looking at our processes to ensure that patients don't stay any longer than they need to in terms of our assessment, treatment and diagnosis stages, and then trying to reduce any delay in discharge. So these are all the processes we're putting in place. But there is a demand issue in the NHS, as we heard from Glasgow. It is increasing, and we work tirelessly day in, day out to develop the services that we need to develop going forward to be able to meet the demands that they're facing us really in the NHS and in social care services over time.
Yeah. I pick up on something here just on the back of Richard, that there seems to be a bit of dubiety about what the figure is for a hospital bed per day. You're saying 170 quid. I've heard when Alec Neil was Cabinet Secretary, he regularly used the figure of £3,000 to £4,000 a week. Audit Scotland are saying £214 a week. Why are we all over the place on this?
We probably both know the answer to that. But
It depends on how you cost that bed, and different boards will cost that based on the bed that the patient is actually in. If a patient's in an intensive care bed, it's a figure. If a patient is in an interim placement, and we use an interim placement different in Ayrshire, where we use a community hospital rather than a care home, that's the cost, £160. So that's the cost you've got in the papers, because we ordinarily don't keep patients in an acute bed where they are waiting for assessment, or if they're waiting to go to a care home, we would transfer that patient to a community hospital bed where possible, and that's the cost of a community hospital bed, as opposed to an acute bed, which can be anything around 260, 350 and upwards. So it just depends on the detail around what that actual bed offers in terms of clinical care.
Colin.
Thanks very much, Convener. I'm interested in some of the barriers that you highlight in your written submission on tackling delayed discharge, in particular what you describe as workforce pressures. To what extent is recruitment and retention of staff a real issue when it comes to tackling delayed discharge, particularly, I suppose, in a rural area like South Ayrshire?
I'll start, and then I think Liz probably be best to talk about the hospital service. I wouldn't want to overstate the issue. I think what we try to do is to include examples of the sorts of things that are at times likely to be problematic. Again, you heard from Glasgow that certainly in their experience, they manage in relation to care at home staff, for example. I think for us in South Ayrshire, that goes probably in peaks and troughs. Sometimes it's more straightforward for us to get staff. We have a very significant, unlike the Glasgow model, which is an arm's length provision of service for care at home through Cordia, we have a mixed economy, probably about 30% in-house service and 70% externally purchased as it happens. Obviously the in-house service tends to pay slightly more in terms of the externally purchased provision. We advertised, this is just a very hot off the press example, we advertised recently for around about 25 staff internally. we got 11 or 12 applicants, and about 10 of those are people who are suitable to take on. So we'll go back out to advert again, and you know, sometimes that could just be because it was the summer holidays and so on. I think the private providers, they are having difficulty with recruitment and retention. That's what they report to us. I think some of the uncertainty that there is currently in relation to the rates that local authorities and partnerships are able to pay providers, I think, is creating a difficulty for them at this stage, both in relation to the national living wage and the living wage from October, the Scottish living wage, if you like. I think in our professional services, if you like, for instance, social workers, district nurses, and so on, again, we do at times struggle for staff, particularly as the question implied. Once you get further down in the county, towards Girvan and other places further down south, further away from the main conurbations, it does become difficult to attract staff. I think probably though the more significant issue for us generally is in relation to hospital doctors and so on. And Liz is probably best placed to answer that.
Yeah, in terms of delayed discharges, I wouldn't say there are delays in the system specifically around the lack of doctors or nurses within the acute environments. We have, however, got challenges around our medical staffing in Ayrshire because we're further away from the central belt. And we do have a number of vacancies in our medical professions, particularly medicine. In our surgical specialties, that's not just such a significant issue, but in medicine, which means that when I referred back to having the best processes in place to ensure that we care for older people in the best way possible, we can have delays if we don't have medical doctors on site to the number that we'd require or with the skills and expertise. But it's not impacting on delayed discharge, but it does impact on the day-to-day management of the hospital when it comes to increasing demands. So we've done lots of different things to improve our recruitment and retention in Ayrshire, and that's included international recruitment. But we do have, in general terms, around 30 consultant vacancies in Ayrshire, and that's significant in terms of the numbers when it's around 230 consultants. So that does impact on current services. In terms of nursing, I think across Scotland now, we're now starting to see some pressure on nursing, because you'll be aware there has been increased agency spend in nursing, which hadn't been a feature in the past. And that is really because of expansion of services. And as we expand services, be it within the communities or in hospital, we do require nurses in a number of different areas, because nurses and allied health professionals are tending to provide the majority of that care, along with carers and voluntary organisation staff. And I think going forward, we have to be careful around the projections of nurses that we train in Scotland, and to ensure that we do have enough staff, because we are investing in services rapidly to meet the demands in the health service. What comes with that is the requirement to invest in clinical staff. And I think we are running a wee bit behind in terms of being able to produce the numbers of staff that are required in Scotland to be able to deliver those high-quality services, both health and in social care. Mm-hmm. And care homes, which is a new phenomenon as well, is starting to see that, because patients in care homes now are more complex than what they might have been 5 years ago. And care homes would have had less registered staff on a shift than what they require now. And we know now that care homes are now struggling to recruit the number of registered nursing staff they need to deliver that nursing care that they would in the past. And we're competing together. So if there's a job in an acute hospital or a job in a care home, the chances are that a nurse that doesn't have a job will apply for the acute hospital post. So it's again trying to keep up with the demand in service. We need to keep up with the demand in terms of the numbers of staff we require. But going back to delayed discharges, it's not having a direct impact, but it obviously does have an impact on our caring services in health and social care.
Can I say
care.
Something about the contractors for the nursing home care? At the current point in time, COSLA is doing an exercise for some of the local authorities in terms of getting costings for the cost of care, because the National Care Home contract is being renegotiated. and that it's the availability of highly qualified nursing staff and what they feel they will have to pay them that is being put forward by them as one of their additional costs, and also their concerns in general that they will not be able to recruit, you know, that quality of the quality of staff that they will require. And as Liz rightly says, as we are making sure more people stay in their own homes as long as possible, it is a more frailer group of people that go to the care homes, and therefore they need more intensive care. So you actually require a different balance of staff. So they will need more and better qualified staff in order to fulfil their duties to their patients. So it's a very complex situation we're in, you know. Make no mistake about that. And I was saying to your chair as I came in, I'm really appreciative that we've been able to come here to tell you about this, because it's so important that we get it right, you know, and that we make sure. And you don't think we're always saying, oh, we need more money. What we're trying to do is use the resource of Scotland better, because we know we've got these challenges coming up in us. But no one's going to take a pocket of money away and, you know, in their pocket for this. But an interesting exercise.
And I think workforce projectors are important. And again, with our system in Ayrshire, we are projecting better into the future about what we require to be able to deliver services in communities as much as in acute environments, because that's where the delays occur if something isn't able to be delivered across the system. So we're doing that as one.
Thanks very much for coming along. Taking it back just to look at the delayed discharge picture, and correct me if I've got this wrong, but you kind of had a reducing trend over a period of time. And then if you look at the graph for the last number of months, you've basically had a situation where, if I'm reading the colours on this chart here correctly, the vast majority of it is because of what you talked to earlier, lack of funding to access care home places. The COVID-19s are actually very small. And if you didn't have that issue with care home places, your graph would probably still be on a downward trend. And we've talked about the financials, and I kind of get that, because you've got a variable cost going out of the care home, your pay per day, whereas on the acute, unless you restructure to take out costs, you've got a big fixed cost, etc. And it's probably harder for you than it is for someone like Glasgow, because you've got less scope to be in a smaller board, etc. So I kind of get that. So I suppose that the question is, if that was simply the case and it's costing you whatever is £100 a night to be in the care home versus £200 or £300 a night to be in the hospital, do you, and you didn't have all this other demand coming in, would you have the scope to restructure to realise those savings? That's the first question. And the second question then is to look at the broader pipeline. And you talked about A&E driving utilisation of acute beds, etc., etc. And you mentioned a wee bit what you're doing there. One of the things we talked about at our weekend session with the GPs, and they basically put a graph up that says the reason why A&E has gone up is because funding for GPs isn't going up, or is going down in real terms. So I don't know if you want to comment on that. Is there an issue there with the gatekeeper, and you're getting extra demand on A&E that's spilling over into acute that's causing this kind of problem further down the line?
I think all of the number of points, obviously, within that question. I think the first point is around about restructuring and looking at our bed models and so on. And I guess implicit in the interim report that is now in the public domain but wasn't before publication for this committee, in terms of the modernisation process that we're undertaking across Ayrshire and Arran, clearly there are discussions about, well, whether we've got the bed model right in a number of areas, particularly in terms of community hospitals and so on and so forth. Now, obviously, there are a number of sensitivities associated with that, but we do recognise that there are probably better ways of managing the resource moving forward. In relation to the issue in respect of GPs, again, I think colleagues from Glasgow reflected again the pressure that there is on general practice. I think not only or particularly in rural areas that there are particular pressures. I think there are opportunities for us to work much more collaboratively with GP practice, and I think we are having a pretty good go at that in Ayrshire and Arran. One of the particular initiatives that I referenced in the papers was anticipatory care planning. And in some ways, there's nothing new under the sun. 25 years ago, you would regularly, I think, have had circumstances in which district nurses, social workers and others were meeting within the GP practice to talk about patients, if you like, at particular risk, and having a conversation about how to maximise the care for that person, what happens if it goes wrong, and so on and so forth. I think our GPs in South Ayrshire, in particular, following a pilot or a test of change that our clinical director pursued within his own practice, are meeting, I think indeed today, with 14 of the other practices within South Ayrshire, with a view to rolling out that methodology. And it's a very simple proposition, but the key to a lot of this, both at the front end of the hospital in general practice, is multidisciplinary work and multidisciplinary decision making. And those are the things that I think we feel are likely to have the greatest impact moving forward in terms of maintaining people within their own homes, rather than perhaps propelling them through a system where care home becomes the default position at the end of the process. But the other part of your question was about acute services, I think, or have I answered it all? I'm not sure if I have.
Yes, right. About if you were to be able to get to the scenario where, in theory, you move people to care homes at a lower per day cost, and assume you didn't have this wave of stuff coming through, would you be able to restructure to take that money out? Which is kind of where the whole discussion
started. And I think there are elements where we could use the money more productively. Whether at the end of the day that will provide the whole solution, I think, remains to be seen. I think one of the things that we feel is significant is, once it's back to that question that was asked of both us and colleagues in Glasgow, is the risk management issue. Once somebody gets to hospital, you're in some difficulty in terms of getting a discharge. For a variety of reasons, particularly a much older person with a degree of complexity, and if our system isn't slick enough to manage expectation with the family and the older person themselves and everybody else, that a quick discharge back home, you know, get the issue fixed, go back home. I don't think our arrangements in Ayr at the moment are sufficiently robust, and we're at the beginning of trying to improve that. I think if we don't get that right, then we'll continue to see that pattern of very, very high demand. I think what we're trying to do, or what we will successively do, is to manage an early discharge and rehabilitation at home, and I think that has to be the way forward.
Just to add to that, we have been bed modelling in Ayrshire for some time, and in South Ayrshire in particular. You'll be aware we've just built a new emergency department, and we're now in a second phase of building a combined assessment unit. That combined assessment unit was modelled on the prevention of admissions where admission is not the right thing, in that this unit is being built alongside the emergency department. It will open next spring. And any patient who is referred from their general practitioner will go direct to that unit. They'll not go to the emergency department, or any patient who has come in on an unscheduled basis through a 999 ambulance or through it being brought in by a carer or a self-presenter will go to ED, but then will be streamed into the combined assessment unit. That unit will allow the multidisciplinary team to carry out that assessment, where we don't have that facility near to do that just now because we're still working with the traditional model of hospital care because of the facilities we've got. So that will allow us to build the teams, and that was built into our model of care. So the time is opportune now, as we have moved forward with our health and social care partnerships, to build those teams, both in the community but both at the front door of an acute service, where we can avoid admissions where we can, and where we can pick up patients or people where we can then help patients back to community, help families understand about care requirements, and do the best that we can prior to admitting someone to an acute hospital bed if that's not required. So that comes in stream in spring, which will give us another avenue to be able to care for patients in a better way.
Yeah, and can I say that in the combined assessment unit, it's a much calmer atmosphere in there. So as our consultants in A&E, they say A&E is not the right place to take anybody in if they are in any way agitated or anything like that. It's very, very difficult for them. And the older and frailer people get, the worse that experience is for them. The other way to look at it is if people have very robust packages of care at home, if you think of the thing that needs the, you know, the extra medical care as a blip in that, rather than as, you know, the full sort of Monty situation, then if you keep them within their package of care, it saves all the bother of reassessing, rejigging. You know, you're putting a whole lot of stress into the system by taking them into hospital for a few days, and then they're in the kind of delayed discharge, all that, you know, reassessment. They're in another route, as it were. So if we can just hold people in a safe and secure way within their own home and only take people out when it's absolutely essential to take them out, when they really need, you know, the heavy duty care, but getting them back, then for the actual individual and the family, it's far better. You know, so it's not that we're going to give in a second rate service. We would want to do it that way. You know, we actually don't want to put people into care homes either. See, we want to keep people out of care homes as long as possible, so that those who have to go into a care home spend as little time there, and then they get the right situation in which to die, you know, with comfort and with their family. So we don't want that old pattern. We want to keep that bit to the minimum.
One of the lessons I took from Greater Glasgow and Clyde when they were in before you was they'd really looked at how they do early hospital commissioning for patients and also how they transition patients. And from what you've said today, what I thought was quite clear and looking at the sort of details of number of beds is actually Ayrshire and Arran have one of the lowest number of NHS and local sector hospital care home places available. I think from a PQ I had in July, it says you've got 94 beds available compared to a similar size health board like NHS Tayside, which has 328. To what extent are you reforming that transitional services so that people are moved out of acute care to be able to then find either go home or have a care home place either in voluntary or the private sector?
I'm not sure that I understand your question in terms of the beds. Which beds are we talking about?
Well, this was in terms of local authority and NHS sector beds. There's 94 care home places available, registered care home beds in that sector. And obviously, we're looking at other health boards who have much larger numbers of beds available for transitioning patients, potentially to a voluntary or a private sector bed. Do you think that the fact you don't have that capacity is having any impact?
Okay. I hope this will be helpful. I'm not quite sure that I'm understanding fully what the issue is here. So in terms of care home beds for long-term care, we're resourcing better part of 900, and you know that's and we've obviously had previous discussion about are there vacancies and so on. In terms of interim beds, which I think is what the issue is, we're obviously not funding those in the way that Glasgow have chosen to. They don't have any community hospitals in the same way that Ayrshire and Arran have. In South Ayrshire, from our perspective, the hospital that predominantly provides, if you like, interim care, a combination of complex care for some people, what might have been previously called continuing care, end-of-life care, and significant amount of rehabilitation support. There are 113 beds at the Bigot Hospital, and a number at Girvan, there are 20 at Girvan, but it's, again, a slightly different model. Do we think that we need more? I think that's actually unlikely that we need more. Of the 113 beds that there are at Bigot, for reasons that we've already explored and are referenced in the paperwork, we were consuming probably two-fifths of those for a period as delayed discharges. And that's essentially a dead weight, that we're not using those beds productively to rehab people. Obviously, we've made a little progress in recent weeks to begin to address that. But I think while you've got those beds with delayed discharges in, you're not really using the facility in an interim way in which would give us best value in terms of real focus on rehabilitation or, where necessary, end-of-life care, for example. So I think what we are expecting as part of the modernisation work that's referenced in the papers, the opportunity presented by being able to tackle significantly the delayed discharges issue in terms of care home is then, I guess, get a better handle on what the real demand for interim placements would be. Your question, though, is it enough? I don't think we know the answer to that, in fairness.
What do you think you can learn from Greater Glasgow and Clyde, then, in terms of how they've put in reforms and how you could maybe pick up some of these?
I think, funny enough, I happened to work in Greater Glasgow and Clyde and worked in East Renfrewshire, and I was pleased to see that the legacy has been good in East Renfrewshire where I worked previously. So much of the learning obviously is known to people around the system in terms of what's likely to work and what's likely to take us in the wrong direction. I think really for us, and as the figures suggest, while in no way would we be complacent, I think if it hadn't simply been for the resourcing issue, I think we would be continuing to use some of the sorts of initiatives that Glasgow and other partnerships have adopted. The Integrated Care Fund, the resources available through the delayed discharges money, I think have allowed us to look at a range of innovations, particularly the sorts of things that are referenced, anticipatory care planning, significant investment in further rehabilitation capacity, enabling us to focus on modernising our care at home service that needed modernisation, a re-ablement service, so at the front end of the home care service, rather than people simply being assessed and getting a service forever and a day. The process at the beginning is very much focused on, well, you know, rehabilitation, using the capacity and ability that somebody has to maximise the ability of them to undertake activities of daily living themselves, rather than us doing it. So again, a number of pieces of the jigsaw, very similar to those that Glasgow and the neighbouring authorities in Greater Glasgow and Clyde will have done. And I think it has for us in that period, hopefully that we're getting past now, been a resourcing issue.
Maybe I could help to just explain the impact in Ayrshire, which is different in Glasgow. So Glasgow explained that patients who were transferring to a care home, there were very little other options in that it was acute hospital to care home, so they were using interim placements, but purchasing a care home place to allow assessment to be carried out, or a period where the patient can't move on because of other reasons. In Ayrshire, we always step down from acute hospital to a community hospital, and that's been our model for many years, and we aspire to retain that model in that the impact in Ayrshire, where there has been delays in recent times, which hasn't been in the past, as Tim's explained, is that patients who would routinely step down to a community hospital for rehabilitation, those beds are not available or haven't been available over recent months, because those patients are waiting to move to a care home. So it's the community hospitals that have got delays, not the acute hospital, but it backs up in that the acute hospital patients can't move as quickly as we'd prefer to a rehabilitation bed. So what we're having to do just now is try and bring in some rehabilitation support in this interim period into acute hospital to try and prevent patients from not benefiting from the rehabilitation if they don't get it. And that has been some of the challenges that we've had to be able to get staff to do that, and that's what we're working on just now while we work through this period where we've had a particular problem really since the beginning of the year. But we always would step down to a community hospital bed so that a patient has got the opportunity to, I suppose, rehabilitate to a point that they may be able to go home with a care package as opposed to going to a care home. So that's why we've avoided using the care home approach, and that's been working well until recent times, until we've had this particular problem.
We've got quite a few people still want in, so if we can be as brief as possible, Claire.
I'll ask two quick fire questions then. First of all, question seven, your response was saying that you had reduced your number of code 9s
delayed discharges. I'd be interested to hear briefly how you've done that and if there's learning for other health boards. And another going off another tangent, we've been very driven by money, process and structure. But at the nub of this is a patient, a person who is not getting to where they need to get to in a timious way. What are you doing as a HSCP to support them and their family?
In terms of the Code 9 issue, I think it's simply been focusing on that, driving the process. Stephen from Glasgow described management oversight, and there has been management oversight of that. I think identification of patients as early as possible or service users as early as possible who may have capacity issues, I think allows you to set in place processes more quickly. And obviously we're pleased that those numbers have come down. Clearly implied in the second question is we recognise that people aren't in the most appropriate place to get care. And that's a frustration, I think, for us as a senior management team, certainly for families and particularly nursing and ward staff at the Bigot Hospital that we were referring to. I think we've tried to keep people as informed as possible in terms of the state of play, but I think we can't escape from the fact that it does create tension and anxiety and frustration for families and staff at the front line.
Richard.
Thank you, Convener. I'll try and be brief. Can I firstly compliment Councillor Rita Miller and our officials on the level of detail that we've got from you, and can I also touch on a sensitive subject, Rita, that you actually touched on a minute ago, was death. I noticed that there are 4,643 deaths in Ayrshire and Arran. Very sensitive subject, and I do apologise if I offend anyone. National Survey, the Audit Office, found that 40% of people who died in hospitals in your area did not have the medical needs that required them to be there. Nearly a quarter of them had been in hospital for a month. 50% of residents admitted to hospital who died could have been cared in a care home or in their own home. I had a situation where a friend of mine wanted out of hospital and sadly didn't get out of hospital. She wanted the dignity of dying in their own home. Do you think we should do more to give people that dignity?
We attempt to ensure that patients can go home to die. That can often be a complex situation in that often it can be families who are scared to take a relative home who may be in the last stages of life. And again, it comes back to the confidence of being able to put in the care and support that family requires, along with aid and adaptations. And we know that sometimes that can take a significant amount of time if patients don't have beds downstairs, etc. And it can often be quite difficult to approach that. Other than that, it comes down to community-based services and whether those services are I suppose have got enough in terms of being able to respond if something goes wrong for families, and again giving them the confidence. But on all occasions we attempt to get a dying patient home, it's the first conversation we'll have, and it tends to be around being able to put those support mechanisms in the home as opposed to not allowing a patient to go home from a medical perspective. We do have multidisciplinary teams on a regular basis. We're getting better at it. And we're also trying to identify now with our health and social care partnerships, again, a possible transfer from acute environment, because hospice doesn't have many beds. It's quite a strict criteria in terms of hospice care. It's not about longer periods of care. So we're looking again at our community hospitals to try and ensure that we do have appropriate capacity in each of those hospitals to either transfer a patient from an acute hospital, if families would prefer that, where families can be with a dying relative. And it means that we're not having to work to put in aids and adaptations and all the other things I've mentioned. Or it means that a general practitioner who's maybe having that discussion with a family, and often the general practitioner gets to the point where they're saying, well, you know, I possibly have to admit your relative if we can't keep your relative at home. It means a family can then work with a GP to be admitted to...
Well,
I'll make one further sentence, I promise.
So it's complicated, as you can imagine, but we are attempting to ensure that dying patients can die at home where possible.
And I think the only other thing that I would add to that is the use of technology-enabled care in order to do that, and could pursue that another time.
Yeah. And Chair, the other pilot is the hospice are piloting at the moment, having a little unit. They did try an apartment, that didn't work very well. They've got a little bungalow in the grounds, which families get the use of, and that does seem to be quite a successful approach at the moment. And it does strike me that we might have something. We have the midwife's unit at the maternity hospital, where people have a little unit that they have privacy in, and the midwife's coming in and out. There might be something like that that we could develop that would give a family a lot of privacy, but still have the hospital stuff around it, as it were, for an emergency, and might reassure the family. I think that would be a much better way to deal with things. So I do think we need to look at this.
New approaches.
And new approaches are required, and we need to look further into how we can do that. Yeah.
Thank you. Keep up the good work.
Yeah. Alec. Thank you, Convener. Very quickly, I'm just interested in how you manage when you have a deficiency of beds for patients to go into after discharge. Do you, what use of out of authority placements do you make? And is that linked to this term hosted services, which I don't quite understand in the budget line? Perhaps you can explain that.
I'll deal with the last issue first. Hosted services, essentially the three partnerships in Ayrshire and Arran recognised that there were some areas of service that it made sense to manage on a pan-Ayrshire basis across the three partnerships. So, for example, mental health services, particularly the hospital inpatient services, are managed by North Ayrshire. They happen to be located within North Ayrshire, but are available to us all. In South Ayrshire, we manage and oversee the allied health professionals. And in East Ayrshire, they have responsibility for the hosted service in relation to primary care and those services. So it's simply a managerial or a governance construct. In relation to bed, you know, I've forgotten the other bit of the question now. Beds,
out of area
beds. I don't think from our perspective that we would have a difficulty with that. I mean, clearly most people wish to be cared for within their own locality. Are we referring to NHS beds, perhaps?
I think it goes back to if we have got delays in our community hospitals. Where I said that obviously those delays can back up into the acute hospital, we create additional capacity in acute services. So that's the impact. And we have done that over recent months in your hospital to enable, you know, good patient flow through the hospital. We've had to create extra capacity.
Just quickly, when you talk about the community hospitals being the provider of the interim, just to be clear, are they out of the delayed discharge figures then? Does that count as a discharge, or do they still come within?
They're still part of the delayed discharges figures. So there are 113 beds in the Bigot Hospital. At any one time, we've had 45 that are delayed discharges in there, and they're reported as part of the figures that are in the papers.
So until they're discharged from the community hospital, they remain?
Yes. So we're resourcing it differently to Glasgow. So in other circumstances, they might appear as a delayed discharge in another area.
That prevents me asking my next question, which was, the extent, was that a shifting of from one hospital to another, but it's still within the system? Yeah, okay, yeah. Thank you. Thanks, Kevin.
Just a final point. It says within the submission that the graph that you provided on placements, the downward curve in the graph from October 2015 reflects a decision by the IGB to reduce care home placements to contain costs within the budget available. That to me would suggest that decisions are being made that are not in the interest of the patient, but are in the interest of the bean counter and the accountant who's saying, you just need to cut this. Whereas, and you're then having to make a decision that says, well, Mrs. Smith actually should be going to a care home, but...
Well, I mean, it was a decision that the board took, and it was, we knew the decision we were taking. Everybody on the board knew that, and we did it with, very reluctantly, of course, but we had to live within our means, and we have to do that. We did ask a lot of questions about how the situation would be dealt with in reality, as you say, but and that no one was put at risk and so on. So those are during our discussion of what was the least worst option, you know, basically was what we were looking for, because we simply had to, we did not have anybody bailing us out in terms of, you know, giving us some more money. I mean, could I say I know, because I've asked my colleagues and that were at COSLA on Friday with me, how did you deal with the situation you had? Because they were in a similar situation. And in some cases, to a certain extent, they've painted over the cracks because they've actually had a subsidy from both their parent bodies, as it were, to just let them go ahead. Now, well, that's fine and that digs them out of the hole this time round, but we also felt we had to make sure we get all the what should we say, it's a whole system we need to change and not just speed up the process and put more people into care homes. You know what I mean? That's not solving the problem. It's not sustainable in the long term. It just isn't. So we have to change the model, and therefore we have to get, you know, more provision put into the community. So it's... I mean, you're right, it's Hobson's choice, you know, not a good choice, but we did discuss it, and, you know, we were concerned about exactly what you were saying, and we were reassured that no person would be at any risk, but it's still not the best situation to be in. I mean, people were in community hospitals, the rehabilitation wouldn't be as active as we might have wanted. All that's true, yes, and we wouldn't want to do it.
Okay. Thanks very much. Really appreciate your evidence this morning. It's been very helpful to all of us, and thank you very much. And we will now go into private session.